So yesterday we saw the point source as well as power pattern. So today we'll look into the topic called as field pattern. Similarly, like your power pattern, here also you have something called as absolute field pattern as well as relative field pattern. Now, whenever you consider the field pattern of point source, the field pattern of this point source is explained in terms of far field. That is, you have to consider the electric field and magnetic field. There are four conditions to remember. The first condition says that your electric and magnetic field, you know, they are perpendicular to each other. The same condition applies. So both the fields are perpendicular to each other. And electric field as well as the magnetic field are perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So along which direction they propagate. So both the fields are perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So that is the second consideration. Third is electric and magnetic field, both are in phase with each other. So whenever you consider both the fields, so you have to consider that both are in phase with each other. And the fourth point you have, that is electric field and magnetic field, both are related with an equation of impedance. You know that Z is equal to E by H, which is equal to, we got some 376.6. So it is like 377 ohm. That is for free space. So far field of a point source, it is explained in terms of a far field. So describe this far field of a point source. You have to consider electric field E and magnetic field H, where electric field and magnetic field both are perpendicular to each other. Electric field and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other along with the direction of propagation. Electric field and magnetic field are in phase with each other, and E and H are related as Z is equal to E cross H, sorry, E by H, which is equal to 377 ohm in a free space. So for a far field of a point source, you have similarly like how it is in the power pattern, you have the component existing, that is radial component of pointing vector, which is we have already taken it as SR. So SR component only exists, whereas theta and phi will not exist. So which is also given by the equation. So half into E square by Z naught. So the same equation, how it is applying for your power pattern, the same. Similarly, it is there for field pattern. Second component you have is, since you have electric field and magnetic field, you will have transverse components, which are nothing but E theta as well as E theta as well as E phi. So that is E theta and E phi. What is transverse component? What do you mean by transverse? If you remember, I've told you in the initial class. What is transverse? See, transverse is something where your one wave, either the electric or magnetic, will be in the horizontal direction, and the other field, that is either your electric field, it will be in the vertical direction. Try to imagine it as one wave traveling in a horizontal direction, another wave traveling in a vertical direction, and there is a, you can see both the waves are together. So such kind of a wave is called as transverse wave. So in that you have the component E theta as well as E phi. So the relation of this radial component of the pointing vector and the electric field components, if you take the relation as SR is equal to half into E square by Z naught. And you know Z naught is the intrinsic impedance, which is usually we consider for a medium. And if you take the total electric field for the transverse component, it is magnitude of, that is square root of E theta square plus E phi square. Since there are two components which are existing. So E is nothing but amplitude of total electric field intensity. E theta is amplitude of theta component. E phi is amplitude of phi component. And
Now you have to define what is actually a field pattern. Now these are all the conditions for field pattern. A pattern which is showing the electric field intensity variation as a function of theta comma phi, then it is called as field pattern. What was power pattern? Anybody? What was power pattern? See, power is something related to your pointing vector. If the pointing vector of a radial component SR is giving a variation for theta and phi, then you call that pattern as power pattern. If the graph or a pattern is showing the variation of electric field intensity as a function of angles theta and phi, then you call it as field pattern. Now here again, you have two different types of field pattern, like your power pattern. It is absolute field pattern and one more is relative field pattern. Now again, in the previous case phase pattern, if you express your radial pointing vector SR in terms of watt per meter square, then it is absolute power pattern. Here, since it is with respect to electric field intensity, if the electric field intensity is expressed in terms of volt per meter, then you call the resulting pattern as absolute power pattern. Absolute field pattern. In case of relative power pattern, you had SR by SRM, something divided by its value divided by its maximum value, which is again a normalized value where the maximum value is equal to 1. That was power pattern. Now here, if you consider for relative field pattern, so here also electric field divided by its, suppose if I take E theta, it is divided by its maximum value, or E phi divided by its maximum value will give you the normalized value En, where the value of E theta max or E phi max is equal to 1. So if you have such condition, then it is called relative power pattern. Both are almost similar. There you will be having something with respect to radial component. Here you have it is with respect to electric field intensity because it is field pattern. There it is power pattern. So power should be related to pointing vector. Field should be related to electric field and magnetic field. Is that okay?
Ma'am, can you repeat it once for relative field pattern?
So relative field pattern, if your electric field intensity is expressed in terms of its value in some reference direction, so it is E theta by E max. So in the reference direction, what you take is the maximum value, which will be the maximum value what you get for E theta or E phi max is 1. So it's value divided by maximum value, which will give you the normalized value of En. So anything which is represented in the normalization form, so that is nothing but your relative field pattern. Even in the power pattern also, pointing vector, if you are representing in terms of its maximum value as the normalized value of power, then you say that as relative power pattern. Similarly, relative field pattern. So you represent your normalized value as, if I take in terms of E theta, this theta value divided by its maximum, or E phi value divided by its maximum, where E theta and E phi are the maximum values of E theta and E phi. So anything you divide by its maximum value will give you relative field pattern. Done? Fine?
Yes, ma'am.
I'll clear the screen. Now you need to derive a small derivation. It's like how actually the power and your electric field are related. It is relation between normalized power pattern and normalized field pattern. So what is actually the relation of power and electric field? What is the relation of power and electric field? You have derived in terms of half power point, then directivity, power radiated. Well, how did you actually, if something is given in power, you have to, or if something is given in electric field form, if you have to write for power, how do you write it? Relation of power. What is the relation of power to electric field? You're writing for electric field half power point 1 by root 2, whereas for power as 1 by 2. At least tell me now what is the relation. If power is 1 by 2, electric field is 1 by root 2, how is this relating?
P square will give the power norm.
Yes, correct. At least somebody replies. Power is equal to E square. See, 1 by 2. If you take 1 by root 2 square, how much? E square. So it is squaring this term, electric field. You did not study this in the third module. I have given you directly. Power is directly related to E square. So you have to derive this relation that power is actually equal to E square, or normalized power is equal to En square. You know, normalized value of En is equal to E theta divided by E theta m. I'm writing the normalized value. This is similarly for E phi, E phi m. So consider this as equation one. Now relate this power to the power. So normalized power is SR divided by SRM, which is pointing vector radial component. But you know that if you consider the pointing vector equation, what is nothing but SR, which is equal to half into E square by Z naught. Similarly, if we consider SRM, it is nothing but half into EM, that is maximum square by Z naught. So just substitute it here, the equation, that is half into E square by Z naught, again half into EM square by Z naught, which is equal to, this gets cancelled, you will have E square by EM. So any value divided by maximum value is nothing but, it is a normalized value. So just substitute it here, that is normalized value is square. So you can say that the power is equal to En square, where EM is the maximum value here of electric field. So you get power is equal to En square. Just direct substitution based on the equations of normalization of field pattern equations. So from this equation, you can say that normalized power pattern is proportional to square of normalized field pattern. Moving on to the next pattern, clear the screen. The phase pattern. Now here in the phase pattern, you have the characterization based on again 4 points. The first one, since you are considering E theta as well as E phi, now the amplitude of polar component. The amplitude of the polar component, which is nothing but E theta, it is as a function of R comma theta comma phi. Similarly, the second function, that is amplitude of azimuthal component, this polar component, or it is also called as latitudinal component E theta, whereas you have E phi is also called as azimuthal component, or it is called as longitudinal component. So again, this is also having the variation with respect to R comma theta comma phi. And the third consideration, phase difference. Phase difference is represented as delta. Of, now you have E theta and E phi. Whenever we consider the function, phase difference delta of E phi behind E theta. That means you have actually in the spherical coordinate system. So this is the angle which you have theta, then comes the angle phi. So E phi is behind your E theta as a function of again theta comma phi. The fourth one, it is phase difference of either field component, which is represented as eta. So here it is again varying with respect to r comma theta comma phi. So if something you are plotting with respect to eta, with respect to theta comma phi, this gives you the phase pattern. So the variation of eta, or the variation pattern which is showing the variation of eta with respect to theta and phi, so that is called as phase pattern, where eta is nothing but the phase difference of either field components. It can be of e theta or it can be of e phi. So here at the reference point, which is also a function of r comma theta comma phi, so based on that you will be drawing the phase pattern. So phase pattern, the characterization of phase pattern is you have amplitude of polar component, which is e theta as a function of r comma theta and phi. Similarly, amplitude of azimuthal component or longitudinal component, which is e phi, of the electric field as a function of r comma theta comma phi. You have phase difference, that is delta, of e phi behind e theta, which is again a function of theta and phi. And you have phase difference eta, which is of either field component, which is having a value at a reference point as a function of r comma theta comma phi. So plot of eta with respect to theta and phi will give you the phase pattern. So the three patterns, this one is a little bit changed because it is phase. You have theta comma phi variation. The other two are variation of electric field intensity with respect to theta and phi. Power pattern is radial component variation with respect to theta and phi. Clear? We'll move on to antenna array. Again, this is important. You have around four cases. So make sure you listen and take down it properly. Now, what is an array? Normally, when we consider certain structures, what is array? Or normal definition of array? There are 78 students.
Collection of data.
Yeah, that is in terms of here, usually when we consider the communication part. So here, when we talk about the structures, again, it applies the same meaning. Instead, there you have so many datas. Here you have array of antennas, one or the similar antennas, which are oriented. So one above the other or one beside the other. So there is a different structure for orientation of the antenna. So when we say antenna array, it is a system of similar antennas oriented in a similar manner so that you have to get the maximum directivity in the required direction. So the main purpose of going for antenna array structure is so that we obtain a maximum directivity for a particular system. So the field contribution of each antenna. Now, suppose if I say you have seen the old antennas which were there initially for a TV connection, something like this. I don't know whether you have seen or not. You remember something like this? Or anywhere you have seen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this is actually this each lines what I've drawn here. So these each are nothing but a kind of an antenna which will have actually the array structure and each will contribute. So it depends on how many lines you put it here or how many antennas you arrange here. So based on that, each antenna here will represent or will contribute to the field and in a particular direction. Whereas some of the antennas, so here it can be from this direction, it will add up. Whereas from this direction, it might get canceled up. So the field contribution, each of the antennas add up in a particular direction and cancel in a particular or the other direction where to get the maximum directivity. If you get maximum directivity, the advantage is the gain will be maximum because you know gain is directly proportional to your directivity. So the main intention of going for antenna array structure is to obtain a maximum directivity either in which direction you consider, so that it will give you the maximum gain. Now, in the antenna structure, you are since studying about the isotropic point sources, you have five different cases. The first case defines that two isotropic sources, antenna sources with same amplitude, and same phase. So you have two isotropic sources with same amplitude and same phase. First, you're considering two isotropic sources. See what introduction of this part I'm deriving now. The same part applies for both, five cases. So I'll be explaining you today. From tomorrow, the second case, I'll be deriving it directly taking the formula. So you have to understand the first concept clearly. Now, to draw this, suppose if there are two point sources here and here. Now I'll consider this as the first point source. I'll number it as one and the second point source as two. So to this point source, there is a mid position. Say I'll consider it as O. And now consider these two point sources, which are again placed symmetrically. So both are equal from the other side. So at a distance of D. Now the total distance what you have from here till here, it is D. So what will be from here to here? It is D by 2. And from here to here, it is D by 2. Just a minute. Sorry for the disturbance. So consider two sources. So you have one source here and the other source here. And both are separated by a distance D. So this will be D by 2 and this will be D by 2. So both are symmetrically placed with the origin O here, and you have an angle phi which is to be measured in the anti-clockwise direction. So it starts from the normal spherical surface. So you're measuring the anti-clockwise direction from the source 1. So if I measure this, say the angle is taken from the center. So I'm measuring from here. So this is your phi. And from here to here, the same angle is coming to your second point, that is to your second source. Now, which source will reach the points earlier? Suppose this is your point P, which I take here. You have point 1 here and you have point 2 here. This one source is rotating at an angle phi. And again, the same angle is rotating for point source P. Which source is able to reach your point P earlier?
2. 2, ma'am.
2. So here, if you consider, since it is very nearer to your point P, so waves from source 2 will reach your point P earlier than your source 1. So again, that is mainly because you have the path difference. So because this path difference is more compared to this path difference. So just draw the extended line till here. And this is again the straight 90 degree line. So it is, make this as 1', which is nothing but 1' is the point source, which is moved after angle phi. Similarly, extend this line to 90 degree and mark it as 2'. So which will again give you the angle rotation point source, that is 2'. So this is the figure how you have to draw. Clear with the figure how you are drawing it. So consider two point sources. You have symmetrical distance. Actual distance from point 1 to 2 is D. Symmetrical, so it is D by 2 from the center for both the sources. You have phi, the angle which is measured in anti-clockwise direction. And when you consider the sources, waves from source 2 will reach your point P earlier than waves from point 1 because of the path difference between 1 and 2. And what exactly you have to do is, you have to find the electric field intensity. So electric field intensity at a point P along the angle that is phi in an anti-clockwise direction. So to find out that, first you have to consider the sources path difference. So now you know the sources, two isotropic sources, this is having the same amplitude as well as you have same phase. So to find out the path difference is nothing but the direction from, that is 1' and 2'. So you can see here, this is the path difference, 1' to 2'. So if I draw it just here, show you. So from 1' to 2' is called as path difference. If I split it and write, you can write it as 1' O + O 2', that is 1' O, O 2'. Now, based on these triangles, you will be finding this 1' O and O 2', because you need to find out what is path difference. So I'll consider first the triangle which you have along the 1'. So it is something like this. You have the triangle there for 1'. So this is your first point, what you have here, and this is your center. Now this, there is an angle, which is 90 degree, or this is the phi angle which we have taken. This angle is the 90 degree angle. The triangle which I've drawn here is this one, this triangle. Now what is cos phi from this? Adjacent by opposite. What is cos phi? What is cos phi? I have drawn you the triangle and given already.
1' O / 1 O.
Yeah. Adjacent is O 1' divided by your, that is O 1. But you know O 1 is what from the figure? What is O 1 or 1 O? What is the distance from here? D by 2. D by 2. So you can write as O1' is equal to D by 2 cos phi. Okay. Now, again, the same procedure has to be applied to the other triangle. The other triangle which is above the axis. So this is going for the 90 degree. Then you have 2' here. You have 2 here and O here. Now, here we actually need O2'. So what is actually, so this is actually D by 2. Here, this is actually D by 2. Now, what is cos phi here in this triangle? So 90 degree is here. If you have problem in that, you can see here cos phi. O2 dash
divided by
O2. So this is nothing but O2 dash divided by D by 2. So you have O2 dash is equal to D by 2 cos phi. Now you got both the path difference. Add to this. So you have D by 2 cos phi plus D by 2 cos phi. So you will get it here as 2D by 2 cos phi. So 2 and 2 will get cancelled. You get D cos phi. Any confusion in this part? Because rest all the cases follows the same. Is it fine?
Ma'am, it will be O2 by O2 dash to ma'am.
See the angle here and you have 90 degree here. That is, you are considering for this angle. So from this angle, if you take adjacent is which one? See here, if I tell you from first triangle, so angle is moving towards, correct, no? Angle is moving towards this direction. So it will be O2 dash divided by O2. This will become adjacent. This will become hypotenuse. So clear this part, path difference?
Yes, ma'am.
On this figure. So you'll get the path difference, so which is equal to 1 dash 2 dash, which is equal to D cos phi. Again, this is in meter. Now, we have to represent in terms of wavelength. So what we do is multiply and divide it by lambda. So this is a lambda and this is lambda. So we write it as D cos phi by lambda. This lambda we write it as wavelengths. So this has to be represented in wavelength. So path difference will be D cos phi by lambda wavelengths. Now you need to find out what is total phase angle. Now here total phase angle is equal to or represented as xi. So it is a symbol like this, which is xi, which is having the general formula. It is 2 pi path difference plus phase angle, that is delta. 2 pi into path difference plus phase angle delta. Now you have got the path difference, substitute it here. So delta will be phase difference. So xi is equal to 2 pi. You have d cos phi lambda as path difference plus you have delta. Now the question or the case says, two isotropic sources with same amplitude and same phase. What happens to delta value here if it is same phase? Whenever it is same phase, you will not have any value for this phase difference. So it will go to zero. So here you will have xi is equal to 2 pi d cos phi by lambda. This is we are taking based on only this condition. If it is given only same phase, then you're supposed to take delta is equal to zero. So first condition, delta will be zero. What is 2 pi by lambda? If you remember the first module, what is 2 pi by lambda? It is a formula. What is beta formula? Is it correct? If you remember, beta is equal to 2 pi by lambda. So you can substitute it here. Xi is equal to beta d cos phi. And this xi is with respect to phi and beta. Beta, we know it is represented in terms of radians. So xi is equal to beta d cos phi radians. So this equation till here, there it is there in all the 3 to 4 cases. So next two, third, fourth case, I'll be directly writing what is xi. So you should be knowing how this has actually come. So you have to do all these procedures and you'll be getting xi is equal to beta d cos phi. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, since the main procedure of this case is you have to find out electric field intensity. Now you have 2 points, 1 and 2. You have to write the electric field intensity. So you are adding up two electric fields. Suppose if I consider source 1 electric field is E1, source 2 electric field is E2. So it is E1 plus you have one more term E2. Now, since you have space, that is xi to represent, e to the power E1 minus j xi by 2, E2 e to the power j xi by 2. Any guesses why this is minus and this is plus? You have e source 1 as minus, source 2 as plus. Can anybody make a guess why it is? See, source 1, it is raised to lagging component or the negative component, mainly because we have seen in the figure which source is reaching faster, source 1 or source 2? Mm-hmm. Source 2. So since it is lagging, so source 1 reaches your point P late when compared to source 2. So this will be raised to lagging potential, this will be raised to leading potential, or this will be represented in negative sign, this will be represented in positive sign, just to show that source 2 is reaching faster than source 1. So this will be in the lagging part, so it is negative. So this is how you write the electric field now, both the electric field patterns of source 1 and source 2. So consider the electric field intensity as point P, which will be E. So that shall write it as E here, which is equal to E1 e to the power minus j xi by 2 plus E2 e to the power j xi by 2, where E1 and E2 will be your amplitudes of radiation from source 1 and 2. And the total phase angle now, it is xi by 2 is the total phase angle. Actually, we have xi. The total phase angle will divide among E1 and E2 because we know in the question itself, it is symmetrical or it is having same amplitude and same phase, and both the D we have taken symmetrical. So since it is symmetrical, it will divide, the total phase angle divides equally between two sources as they are symmetrically placed. So it is xi by 2, xi by 2. So source 1 is raised to lagging potential or exponential factor because waves from source 1 reaches the point P late when compared to source 2. So source 2 is raised to leading potential or exponential factor. So now given the isotropic sources, the question says both the isotropic sources are having same amplitude, which means I have to make E1 and E2, both the amplitudes of source 1 and source 2, to same amplitude. So I'll take it as E0. So E is equal to, you can take out E0 outside, you'll be left out with e to the power minus j xi by 2 plus e to the power j xi by 2. But we know the formula. What is e to the power j theta plus e to the power minus j theta by 2?
Sin theta. Sin.
Cos theta, ma'am.
Cos theta or sin theta?
Cos theta.
This is cos theta. If you have sin theta, you will have minus and a j here. So just substitute it here to this formula in terms of cos theta. What will be the formula here if I write for cos theta? Just tell me what exactly comes in terms of theta. You have only this part. So you have to multiply it by
2
E0 or multiply and divide by 2. That is also fine. Multiply both the equation, divide it by 2. Now tell me what exactly is the formula. This will be cos. Theta value is nothing but xi by 2. So you have 2 E0 cos xi by 2. Now, since we don't want this to E naught, it has to be normalized. When they say normalized, it is nothing but 2 E naught, you are considering the value as 1. So you need to normalize this. We don't want this factor to be in the equation so that the pattern goes wrong. So in order to normalize the pattern, the magnitude must be made equal to 1. So therefore, 2 E naught is equal to 1, which will be cos xi by 2. Now you know the xi value. So electric field intensity, this is nothing but E normalization value. En is equal to cos xi by 2. Now substitute the value of xi. What is the xi value you got? Or xi equation we got? Beta d cos phi by 2. So which is equal to cos of beta, we know it is 2 pi by lambda d value. Now here we consider always d value as lambda by 2 dipole. So it is lambda by 2 cos phi by 2. So lambda gets cancelled, 2 gets cancelled. You have the equation cos phi by 2. So this is the normalized equation of the two sources which you have placed with same phase and same amplitude. Now you have to draw the figure. Now, is that clear till here? How do you take it? All procedure remains same. Whenever you get your 2 E naught, maximize it. You'll get cos xi by 2. Xi value in the first equation, it was beta d cos phi by 2. Beta, 2 pi by lambda. D value, you take it as lambda by 2 dipole. Cos phi by 2, so which is cos phi by 2. Clear? If you want me to explain, I'll explain it once again. Make sure you are understanding. Now you have to draw the field pattern. To draw the field pattern, you have to find out the maximum value, the minimum value, and half power points. So we'll start with the first one, that is how we actually do the maximum direction. So in order to go for a maximum direction, this procedure again remains same for all. You find maximum direction by taking maximum value of normalization plus or minus 1. You have got the normalization value of this case as cos of pi by 2 cos phi. Now you have to substitute here plus or minus 1. Since you are finding maximum direction, it will be cos of pi by 2 cos phi max. So whenever you do maximum, take it as maximum direction, plus or minus 1. Okay. Next, to simplify this, pi by 2 cos phi max is equal to, bringing this side, here you will have two values. So plus or minus cos inverse of plus or minus 1. So it will be pi by 2 cos phi max, which is equal to. Now tell me, when will you have cos value? General equation, you have to tell me. Cos of 1, when do you get? Cos of, or tell me the value itself. Cos of minus 1, when do you get? Cos inverse.
Cos pi equal to minus 1.
Okay. Now, if you are getting 1 means it is, cos 1, cos inverse of 1 is how much? Cos inverse of 1?
0, ma'am.
0. What is cos inverse of minus 1?
180, ma'am.
180. So, if you are writing it for general equation, because 3 pi, 2 pi, 5 pi, 6 pi, everything will have you, you will be getting the value as plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1. So, it will be continuously changing. So you can write generally the equation as, because it starts from 0, 1, 2, 3, and it goes on for all the values of n. It can be your plus 1 minus, plus or minus, plus or minus. So I can write this general equation as n pi for cos inverse of plus or minus 1. Is it correct? You can write n pi, no? 1 pi, 2 pi, 3 pi. It can be either plus or it can be either minus. So everything will give you the value 1. So in general, if you are writing, it is plus or minus cos inverse of plus or minus 1 is equal to plus or minus n pi. So where n will take the value 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3. Now, when you draw the direction or draw the maximum direction, generally we take n is equal to 0. So you take n is equal to 0, pi by 2 cos max is equal to, this value will be 0. So you have cos phi max is equal to, again 0, because pi by 2 into 0, phi max is equal to plus or minus cos inverse of 0. So what is the value? Check the value of phi max. How much you'll get? When do you get cos 0?
90, ma'am.
90. So it is plus or minus 90 degree, or the same I can write it as 90 degree, or minus 90 degree is nothing but 270. So either it is 90 degree or 270 degree. So for this particular case, when you consider two isotropic sources with same amplitude and same phase, you will get the maximum direction of the sources in 90 degree or 270 degree. What does this mean is your main beam area or main major lobe. So if I draw your pattern, the major lobe will be coming in this direction. So this is your 90 degree. This is your 270 degree. Now the next thing is you have to find out the minimum direction, like your side lobe, or where is the minimum direction coming. Then after that, you will be finding what is half power points you are getting here. So which is the next thing you are doing. First, since you have found out already maximum direction, you have to find out what is minimum direction, then half power point direction. Does any confusion in deriving maximum direction?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Just the thing is, you should know what is the general equations to write for cos inverse of plus or minus 1, cos inverse of plus or minus 0, similarly for 45 and sine. So all comes in the different cases. So that one, if you know, and if you directly substitute n is equal to 0, you'll be able to find out what are the